right. Welcome, everybody, to the Hangout, to the little variety hour, which is never an hour. We just kind of let it go. And they usually do, like this one will, no doubt. This is going to be a great one. Tonight, we're talking about interesting photographers that we found on Google+. This is just a small sampling. I think most of us spend an inordinate amount of time on Google+, getting inspired by all the people that we found. But I want to take an opportunity to kind of, you know, share the love a little bit and show off some other photographers that maybe you haven't heard about yet, and maybe you might like to follow too and circle up. Then they'll inspire you as much as they've probably inspired a lot of us. And also, I want to welcome the whole Twit audience, which is watching now. I appreciate you guys very much, too. I'm in the chat room, so is everybody else. If you're watching on Google+, I think we've all kind of shared into our streams, but you can join the live chat room over on Twit, and we can answer questions. We'll do Q&A at the end, just like always. So we welcome you in there, sort of a fun time to join the live chat. All right, so here's kind of the order of operations tonight. Hangouts are always really quite freeform, and I'm just sort of a ringleader of sorts, I guess. I like them to go whichever direction they happen to go. But we do have sort of an order of things. We'll say hello to everybody. People can introduce themselves and plug whatever the heck they want to plug. And then we will go through and show off different photographers that we found in Google+. We'll share a small number of their photos so you guys can see it. And then, after we kind of go around the horn, we'll all share some of our own photos that are new, maybe the world hasn't seen yet, because I know everyone wants to see the latest from Thomas or see what Kelly might pull out of her purse or what have you. And then we'll do Q&A. All right. Okay, so that's kind of how we'll go. Well, let's start with my friend in New Zealand. This is Gordon from CameraLabs.com. Hello, Gordon.
Hi, Trey. Hello, everyone. Thanks for having me on. I run a site called CameraLabs.com where I review cameras, lenses, and accessories. So if you're looking for a new camera and you're wondering how it performs next to other ones, check it out. Trey said I was allowed to show you the latest thing that I've done at Camera Labs. It's actually not a review, but we've just published our first ebook. This is what it looks like on the iPad. It's a book about wildlife photography. So if you're into wildlife photography, you want some great tips, check it out. It's at CameraLabs.com. Thanks again for having me.
All right, very cool. Ebooks are the future. I'm with you, brother. All right, let's say hello to Chee Chew from Google. Hi, Chee.
Hi, guys. Thanks for having me on here. I mentioned to a few of my friends earlier, but I feel a little bit daunted here because I think I'm the primary non-professional photographer in the group. I'm completely amateur. I just kind of shoot for fun. But I love photography. And you guys, by doing this hangout here, are implicitly plugging what I want to plug, so I don't have to push it any further than that. So I work for Google, and I manage the engineering team that builds hangouts.
All right, great. Well, I've been enjoying seeing your photos come across, and I guess we'll get to see some of your work tonight, too, as well as some of the people you've figured out that you might like to show off. So thank you, Chi. Let's say hello, kind of going randomly. Let's say hi to Kelly.
Hi, everyone. I'm Kelly. I am a stay-at-home mom that has gotten hooked on photography, and so I'm trying to, you know, get my claws into everything and never put my camera down and all that good stuff. I am one of the co-curators of Macro Monday. Yay, Macro Monday! wow, that sounded like it was like part of the people. That's probably not cool, but Macro Monday, awesome. I'm also one of the co-hosts of Life Through the Lens. That's a bi-weekly show, and we have a show coming up, but I will let Karen plug that show because she's also one of the co-hosts of that show. That's it. If you want to see any of my images, you can find them on Google+.
All right, thank you very much. Look who just jumped in. It's Sergey Brin. Hey, Sergey, how are you?
Hi, Trey. Thanks for the invitation. I have to confess, I'm not going to be able to stay too terribly long, but very excited to be with all these distinguished photographers.
Oh, well, thanks for coming. We appreciate you and everything you built very much. We'll talk about photography tonight and not too much about Google, although you're welcome to plug this thing you've built by chance.
Well, I'm going to focus on my photos, though I should say hi to Chee. Nice to see you, Chee.
Good to see you. Thanks for coming in.
Cool. Well, we're just going around with introductions right now. Let's say hi to Thomas Hawk. Hello, Thomas.
Hey, Trey. How's it going?
Good.
Good. So I'm Thomas Hawk. You can find me at thomashawk.com or, of course, Thomas Hawk on Google+. Just an easy search for Thomas Hawk comes up with lots of stuff. And I also host a photo show every Wednesday night at 8 p.m. Pacific Standard Time called Photo Talk Plus, along with my co-host Lotus Carroll.
Great. Good to see you, Thomas. How about you, Karen? Give us the scoop on Karen.
How about me? Hi, everybody. I'm Karen Hutton. And I have two halves. Well, I have many halves of my world, but there's the voiceover and there is the photography. They come together in a beautiful app called Stuck on Earth by our own Trey Radcliffe. I'm the voice of the guide on Stuck on Earth. And you can find my voiceover work at KarenHutton.com. Indeed, I am one of the hosts of Life Through the Lens. That is on biweekly, as Kelli said. Our next show is January 31st, where our guest will be the great Jaime Ibarra. And you'll see his work tonight. My photography work is at Google+ and KarenHuttonPhotography.com, and it is a joy to be here.
Well, thank you, Karen. I didn't ask you to plug Stuck on Earth, but it's a free app, so I don't mind plugging a free app. Thank you for all your work there, too. And let's say hi to Chad, who's helping us out at Twit. Hey, Chad.
Hey, everybody. How's it going? This is so exciting. I was just explaining to Brian here how cool this is. It switches for me. I can lock on people. This is just such an amazing idea, and I'm very excited to see the rest of the show. So back to you guys.
Cool. Well, thank you, Chad, for all your help there. Well, we're going to get started by showing off a few different photographers and this sort of thing. Sergey, since you don't have too long, I did want to ask you something about photography. And you know, you're welcome to share some stuff if you can actually start if you like. You know, you're known for you know, building Google or whatever, big deal, right? But also, you know, you do photography, right? And you've been sharing your stuff. And is this sort of a second love for you? And what's it like to share your photography online?
I enjoy sharing my photography quite a bit. You could say the Google thing, you know, you can just get lucky on one company. But it takes, you know, a lot of work and skill to be able to deliver lots of great photos. So I don't know how well I'm doing the photography department, but it's definitely lots of fun to have completely new works every single time. Let's see, I didn't fully prepare. I know you asked me to have a few of my photos ready to go and a few of other people's. I was just looking at one, actually. How do you folks do this? Do you just copy and paste URLs, or?
Well, do you have a little screen share button up there? There's a guy in here named Chee Chew who might be able to help you with Hangouts.
Should I just pick the window that I'm in? Hang on, I'm kind of scared.
Yeah, click screen share, and then you can pick a different window to share.
Take a little doing. I'm just, because I want... but anyway, the photo I'm going to pick is this one of this fellow named Edward, who I posted a little while ago. He lives by himself on an island. I wanted to highlight a few different things about it. Oh, there we go. Okay, I've got him by himself now in a window. One momentito. There we go. Okay. You should be now seeing... this one particular photo, and you can just see it in my stream. One thing I want to note is I shot this with not like a full frame SLR. This is the Sony A77.
Right.
And I started using that more recently. I really like the technology some of these newer cameras are going with, especially like this one's not technically mirrorless, but it's got the continually static 10% mirror or 15%. And it has a lot of tricks up its sleeve. But frankly, I'm impressed with the image quality. The real downside in my mind is that it's not a full-frame sensor. And when you start shooting like in lower light and whatnot, you know, the noise inherent in the smaller sensors becomes evident. But one thing you'll notice here, I didn't do this, is just, I think, pretty much on auto. It kept the blues blue. I found with my Canon SLRs, oftentimes it'll blow out the blue on you know, the exposure control. Just you end up with a sky that's kind of grayer than it really is, because the blue value will have shot past its maximum. But the Sony does, I think, a better way of better job of controlling the exposure, and kind of you get to, you know, this is obviously brightly lit. And you get very good. Can you guys see my mouse there? No. But anyway, you get fine detail in the in-focus region, and very good color. I mean, I don't remember. I might have tweaked this slightly with. I hate to sound like I'm advertising our own products with Picasa, but this isn't even photoshopped or anything. I think it was very marginal adjustment.
Yeah, it looks great. We talked last week all about these SLTs and these mirrorless cameras, and how, you know, a lot of us think that DSLRs might go away in the future. And I know that camera very well, that A77. It's a fine machine, and I'm Sony curious myself.
Yeah, I'm waiting to get. I haven't been able to really get one. They're all out of stock, but the next sevens. I don't know. I guess maybe their factory has got affected, but either by the tsunami or by the Thai floods or something. But the next 7 sounds like it's very similar to this A77, but even more compact. So I'm pretty excited about that. I'm going to turn off screen sharing. Now you all know what image I was talking about. I wish some of these newer technologies were applied to, you know, still full-size sensors, because I do feel like you start to get into battle of technology versus physics, and they're both pretty important.
Yeah, I know. Go ahead, Gordon.
Sorry. I was just going to say, the benefit of the Next 7 is that you get the same sensor as the A77, but you don't have that fixed mirror in front of it soaking up 30% of your light. So you get the same resolution, the same kind of color rendition, but it becomes suddenly more sensitive because there's no mirror in the way. So the Next 7 is a really nice solution for that.
Do any of you actually have one? I just looked online and, you know, looked on Amazon and whatnot, couldn't find it available. But
I don't feel so bad that I can't get one now that I hear that you can't get one.
I don't know. I just I shop online just like everyone else.
Cool. Well, thanks for showing us that. I'll go ahead and show off a few other photographers I found thanks to Google Plus. And I'll kind of, you know, you guys get an idea of how quickly we can move through this stuff. Just, you know, I think we could spend hours talking about every one of these photographers on here. But this is just sort of like a little buffet, sort of an amuse-bouche of sorts. Okay, so let me share my screen here. And, you know, anyone can feel free to chime in. I don't want to dominate the conversation or anything as I show this. And then we'll go to Thomas next. Let me find, here we go. Here's my iPhoto. So this is sort of a wild card I just threw in. I've been following this girl for a while. These images that she comes up with are just crazy. I mean, obviously they're macabre and different and this sort of thing. She does sort of horror type stuff, but I mean, I would love to see like a movie just even based on this image. Her name is Diane Tunstall. And
Danielle.
I'm sorry. Yeah, that's correct. And she has all kinds of images. I'm just going to show one of hers. And I hope that intrigues you enough to circle her and go look through her stream and through her albums, because it's just really, really interesting. So here's another one of my people that I chose. Her name is Midori Chan. She is a Japanese photographer. And she has incredible range. Of course, she's in beautiful Japan, which is almost like cheating if you just live there because there's so much awesome stuff. But she just comes up with these images that are amazing. And she travels all around the world and does all kinds of images. This is in the Sahara. I don't know where this is, but it's awesome. Here's another one of hers that I think is really, really nice. And she's got incredible range. And I was talking on the phone last night with Tom, and we just couldn't believe that anyone has so much range. I didn't even show all of her flower pictures and everything, but she is great. That's Midori Chan. Definitely circle her up and look through her work. She's fantastic. Now, here's a new guy that I found thanks to Google Plus. Actually, I had so many people recommend that I follow this guy and circle him that I did. And I'm so happy. His name is Hengki Koentjoro. I don't know anything about this gentleman. But, you know, actually, sometimes I kind of like not knowing about him because I kind of intuit their soul through their photos. He's great. You probably get a good sense of it just from that one picture. As far as I can tell, he does exclusively black and white. And he just comes up with these very romantic compositions. It gives me all kinds of ideas. He makes me want to go out and shoot black and white photography. And to me, this is the kind of guy that, you know, it doesn't matter how many years you've been shooting or if you're just getting started, this is the kind of guy that gets you interested in photography. And it's, he just gives you so many ideas because, I mean, as creative as we think we are as photographers or whatever, you see other people's creativity and you think, oh my gosh, you know, it's limitless, the compositions and the ideas you could come up with. And this guy kind of gives a window into that. Now, this is Jaime Ibarra. He is a wonderful photographer. It sounds like he's going to be on Karen's show coming up, so you can find out more about him.
January 31st. Yep.
On the 31st. I think he was on Hangout number 10 with me a while back, and he is great. Actually, he just goes on and just talks about his photos and how he comes up with these things. I like him because, well, obviously for the images, but I also like that he's sort of self-taught and he just figures out this stuff himself. It just kind of goes off and spirals off out of control and does his own thing. You know, like this is a girl here in Austin, and she's like an accountant or something, and she came over and wanted him to take her picture, and he just kind of just came up with this. You know, I don't know how he does it. Anyway, just remarkable. That's Jaime Ibarra. And I plus mentioned him, just like everybody else, so you guys can easily circle him up. Okay, so those are kind of my three. Let's go to Thomas. Thomas, do you have some people you'd like to share?
Okay, I sure do. Let me just pull this up. Share selected window. Okay, I think, can everybody see it now?
Yes.
Oops. Okay, good. Okay, so this first person I'm sharing is Ivan Makarov, who is a friend of mine, and let
me get. He's doing the book too for the Google Plus book, right?
He is. He's doing the G Plus One photo collection, which is terrific. I guess there's like 300 photographers that have contributed to this book.
Sergey, are you going to be in that book?
You should get Sergey in there. I'm not sure I've quite followed the book, to be honest with you.
Uh-oh.
I'd be happy to, but
Well, he might have missed the deadline, because the deadline was yesterday, but somehow I have a sense that if Sergey wanted in, Ivan could make an exception.
Well, only if my photos speak for themselves and are worthy.
Well, the thing that Ivan is doing is wonderful because it's getting the community together, and basically he asked everyone to get their best photo from 2011, and then we're going to publish this group book. It's a wonderful sort of collaborative community thing that's come out of Google Plus, which is just, I love seeing that sort of stuff. So
well, I'm happy to participate in any way, but I haven't kept track with it. I'm not very good with deadlines either.
Okay, well, we may try to get an image in yet. So anyways, these are Ivan's photos. He does a lot of work at the coast, which is some beautiful black and whites, which I love. He also does, let's see, here's a black and white photo of his. Wonderful, just midair. You get the water below and just this sort of perfect pose as the dive is going off. Yvonne is a father and does wonderful photos of children and babies. This is his son when he was born shortly after. And I just love how he uses depth of field here, how you've got the feet in focus and you've got such soft, muted colors with the white and the blue. And this is a somewhat famous pier. This is down the peninsula off the coast, and it's sort of a abandoned pier that's obviously missing most of the pier. And it's a long exposure shot, and you can see just how the clouds and the mist and the sea just blends in to create this really dramatic black and white effect. So Yvonne was the first photographer I wanted to share. My co-host on Photo Talk Plus is Lotus Carroll, and I wanted to show some of her work as well. Lotus does a lot of self-portrait work.
I thought that was you, Thomas.
Oh, you thought those were my legs?
Yeah.
No, not quite. Not quite. But I love just sort of the focus on the leg all the way down as the line runs down the leg along the bottom of the foot. I think the lighting is just great. And so that's one I wanted to show. Lotus does a lot of self-portraiture work. This is another one of her self-portraits. What I like about this one is she took it with an iPhone. And so I think a lot of people think, oh, well, you know, I can't do much with camera, you know, phone type stuff. But I thought it was a very great self-portrait, and it also shows some of the processing skills involved. But, another self-portrait of Lotus. This one a lot of people thought was actually a photograph of Lotus, but it's not. It's actually a neighbor girl with her son, and they've fallen asleep on this couch, and you can see the dog sleep there in the shoes. And it reminds me of something like Mary Ellen Marks might have taken or something, just a real sort of documentary style, beautiful photograph. And then this is actually, I'm a little biased because I'm in this photo. I'm the guy on the far left. But Lotus and I went and shot Detroit for the auto show with Ford. And as part of that, apart from that, we went out and did some urban exploration photography. And we got up early one morning to catch the sunrise at Boblo Docks. Which are some docks right on the river that separates Detroit and Canada. And we got up for sunrise, and while most of us were shooting plain old boring sunrise photos, she was capturing silhouettes, which I thought turned out real well. And then the last photographer I wanted to share with everybody is Vivienne Gucwa, who is a New York photographer. There's a wonderful Google Plus sort of New York photo scene going on. I don't know if you guys have watched this, but with people like Leanne Staples and people of, you know, they're doing a bunch of photo walks, and we're going to have actually, I think, all New Yorkers on our show on Wednesday night, and we'll talk about some of the New York photography. But Vivienne's going to be on our show on Wednesday night. But these are some of her photos. You know, I love what she's done here with the light in Chinatown, in New York's Chinatown. You can see those shadows coming off the fire escape. I love how she does that. Here's another one of her photos. This is one of my favorite places to shoot in New York. It's in Central Park, and it's this sort of alley with all these trees. And when they get covered with snow, I've done some photos of this myself in New York, and it's just beautiful. And here she's got just sort of the perfect color element with the umbrella in the middle. And I thought that that turned out real well. Here's another shot of hers of some tulips. I mean, just again, very vibrant, striking color. And then here's a pretty traditional New York scene that she's done. Everybody's seen the Empire State Building. But I love the processing here. I love the coloring. I love how, you know, you've got this sort of dark vignette at the bottom. I love sort of the bright overexposed area in the center of the photo. So I thought, both an interesting subject matter and architectural shot, but also the interesting processing that she seems to do so well as well. So anyways, those are the photographers that I wanted to share.
Cool. Thank you, Thomas.
Oh, Trey, if I may, I just before I sign off, I have to run off in a second. There was one other photographer I would love to introduce you to.
Yes, sir. Go ahead.
All right. So this is Helminadia Ranford, who I don't actually know, but I've been following her on Google+. And this is probably one of the, one of my favorite examples of her work, mostly because it just creates these amazing landscapes that look quite alien. And I'm pretty excited to actually visit some of these places just based on seeing her photos. So that's a favorite of mine. And I just wanted to encourage all
cool.
of you all
it's amazing.
To follow her.
Beautiful. Sergey, do you know where that is, where that was taken?
Yeah, that's Mount Bromo in Indonesia. I've never been to Indonesia, but it looks amazing. And and I got the feeling that, based on her other posts, it wasn't like she's not a volcano chaser. So I got the feeling this was, she was not like so lucky to get the, she was not trying hard to get this. It happens that she traveled there and there was a little bit of activity. But the feeling I got was, you could go there and see these beautiful things, but perhaps not capture it quite so beautifully if you're not so skilled.
Cool.
That is magnificent.
Anyway, I just wanted to share that one with all of you. Unfortunately, I have to run off, but I'd love to catch all of you again. And of course, I'll try to catch this recorded later on.
All right. Excellent. Well, thanks for coming, Sergey. See you around. Go do
nice
awesome
to see
things.
You.
Bye.
Bye. Okay. Now that he's gone, we can all relax a little bit.
Thank God.
Gosh. I didn't think he's never
She's like,
quiet.
Oh, the boss is gone.
Yeah.
No. Yeah, you can't fire you guys.
and then Trey says, did I say that out loud?
No, I wonder if he was watching the chat stream.
He's a cool photographer. We all like him.
Mm-hmm.
Whether or not he founded Google, he's cool. All right, so let's go next to Karen. Karen, why don't you share something awesome with us?
I will do that. I just have to choose my little screen. Then I'm going to go full screen with it. Can you see that?
We see a blank screen, Karen.
Right.
You can't go full screen with it because it shares the original window. Right?
Can you see that?
Yes.
Yes. All right. I nearly had an anxiety attack when you said pick your three favorite because I'm like, what? I've got like 20 in every department. So I had spent a day kind of sweating and breathing hard. And then, for the anxiety reason, don't go there. I then decided that because in my own work, just the stuff I'm exploring is story and fantastical and, that altered reality kind of thing. I find myself going to people like Laura Ferreira. I believe that's how you say her name. And she's a photographer and a graphic artist, and she does stuff like this that I just think is so cool. So I go there, and it isn't necessarily that I do what she does or even think I could do what she does.
Wow.
But I look at that, and I just think different. I just start going, oh, look at that. And you can look at the root of a tree.
Crazy.
And and sort of imagine that. And, of course, elephants are just, love elephants so much. And then I sometimes feel I resemble this remark. Love it. I don't know that I could ever, but I just look at it and I'm completely inspired by her work in every way. My second one, actually, I didn't mean to, but I came up with four. So I'm apparently a rule breaker tonight. But Alan Shapiro, that's not the one we want to look at. No, wait, how did we get there? Sorry, I'm just going the wrong way. I can steer. Don't get on my case. Alan Shapiro is a photographer here on Google+, whom I adore. And I love his texture work and layers. And this just blows me away because this bird is like, coming out of the monitor at me and pecked me on the cheek one day. It was kind of weird. But anyway, I love that part. And then his natural world and his colors and, use of the focus. And it's one way that I see the world in this micro focus. And I just really, really enjoy it. He did the same thing here, which this is a squash. And yet it looks like this bizarre creature from the, you know, Black Lagoon, and I love it. And I love his black and white work, because my beginnings were in black and white, and of course I love animals, and, you know, anybody can get an ape to look at you like that, honey, he's got something going on, you know what I'm saying? And he was on your show, wasn't he, Thomas, on Photo Talk Plus?
Muted, Thomas, muted.
Oh.
There we go. Is that better?
There we go.
Yeah.
Yes. Yeah, Alan was on our show. We did an interview with him, which was great. And he's actually going to be a panelist on this show on Wednesday night as well.
Oh, that's fantastic. So you can go to Photo Talk Plus Tuesday night and hear him there. He is wonderful.
Wednesday. Wednesday.
Wednesday. I'm sorry. I've got Tuesday on the brain for some reason. Wednesday. Now, this is a photographer who is whose name I can't quite pronounce. But he is, I love his texture work and his minimalist work. Same guy does this.
Oh, that's and gorgeous. This.
I know.
I don't have a person circled. I need them.
I know. And this. Philippe. I thought he actually has all these water. What am I trying to say with a signature on it?
There we go. Philippe Sainte-Laudy.
Thank you.
Yes, he's French. He's a friend. He's an incredible photographer.
Oh my God.
That guy is insane.
Insane.
Yeah.
Insane. I had a really hard time picking, you know.
I bet you did. Yeah.
Oh, I mean, I just, oh, wow. This, the perspective and the color and, you know, again, the perspective and the use of light. I mean, I love what he does with light. This is just, it's just crazy.
Yeah, and it seems a shame to only show four or five photos.
I know.
But I hope it just intrigues people to go circle all these people and drink in their work.
Exactly. That's what they should do. They should absolutely do that. The final one, and I'm hoping this shows up, the largest size I could get were small. Klaudia J, that's Klaudia with a K. Klaudia J does this, and it's usually really muted tones and textures and layers. This, with the use of her light and what you can, it's almost as exciting what you can't see in this as what you can. And I love that. I love the colors and the leading lines. Same thing here, the point of focus. With all that you can't quite see in the background, it just makes you so curious and takes you into it. And again, love black and white. Same thing here. So those are my four. And they all just sort of pique my, you know, story imagination. Like I can pick up my camera after that and just go, I've got new ideas. I love that. So
cool. Thank you, Karen. Hey, before we go to Chee, I realize I forgot to introduce and thank Dave Veffer. I guess because we had the timer up, I was thrown off. But how are you, Dave? You're muted.
I'm good. Thank you.
Oh, no, you're not muted.
Go, Dave.
You can find me at plusdave.com.
All right.
Thanks. Happy to be here.
Thank you, Dave. All right, Chee, you're on the pitcher's mound. Don't mess
up. I didn't quite follow the rules, and I'm glad to hear that a few other people didn't quite follow the rules either. I picked three photographers who are on Google Plus, and I was told not to pick Trey, but I picked Trey anyways.
Gee, you don't pick me. All right.
You rebel.
But I'll tell you what, can you see this? My uplink on my hotel is kind of low, so hopefully this will come through.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mentioned this before to, I think, Dave. There are, like, five big photo events in my life. Each of them cost me several thousand dollars. Going out on my own, and so I bought my first camera, so I bought all the stuff with it. Having a kid, so I had an excuse to buy N70, and I spent a lot of money buying a film camera. And then I kind of plateaued. Like, a lot of hobbies, you, like, do something, and then you kind of get better at it, and then you plateau for a while, and you get kind of frustrated, and then something happens, and you kind of start growing again. So one of the other photographers is someone I'll get to who sort of got me to get reinvigorated. And I had my second kid, and then I hit a plateau, and then met Trey here on Google Plus, and like on Google Plus, my first introduction to him, and his photography thing is amazing. But this picture actually really hit home for me because what he told me about this one, if I remember this right, is that he said that you really screwed up this picture, that it was dramatically overexposed, and you sort of recovered it. And that sort of made me sort of think, wow, I have lots of overexposed photos. And maybe, like, I could somehow learn how to make one of them look like this. So so this one has special meaning for me. This one, the Temple of Heaven, is one of my most favorite places on Earth, especially if you go early, early, early in the morning and there's no one there. It's so peaceful, and like I just kind of connect there. So I love that. Google, of course, means a lot to me right now. And I go there, and like this is kind of how I look at Google. This is how I see it. But my pictures of it don't turn out this way. So that kind of inspires me. And this one is the capital of Texas in Austin, if I'm correct on that. And like I have a picture at the same sort of location that looks nothing like this. So this is like the inspiration of kind of where the other picture that I took about 8 years ago.
Yeah.
Hopefully one day it'll go. So that's why I picked you, Trey.
Wow.
Yeah, you had that effect.
Thanks.
Rock on. I'm behind you, Chee. I'm with you, Chee.
The other photographer that's now on Google Plus, he doesn't have a lot of photos here, but he also cost me a lot of money, is Joe McNally. And is this cover of his book, The Hot Shoe Diaries. Like, I saw this and I was just sort of floored. And before reading that book, like, I sort of tried to capture the picture of sort of what's there. And the thing that really hit home for me was how he manipulates light, where he makes light do what he wants it to do. And he uses these little, like, small flashes to do it, which is stunning to me. And so I ended up buying an SB 28-800 and 900 because of him. And I started playing around with gels and all that sort of goo. So I love these photos from him. I love the color of this. This is a beautiful young woman here with that gorgeous background. And the lighting, I just love how the whole thing is lit. And when you think about it, it's like you can tell that he placed the light there. It just didn't happen just to be there. So I love that. And then the other one is here, Mike Shaw. And he has quite a wide range, from these portraits, black and whites. And I have a hard time with portraits. I'm always impressed by someone who can really not only capture aesthetic, but also capture meaning and expression. And so I like his portraits. But he also does these great landscapes with amazing color. And this is a beautiful picture and the pebbles under the water just really stand out to me. So I find this one stunning. And then, like, this is a black and white that really, like, screams color to me. Like, I can just imagine the colors, but there's no color in there. So I love this photo. So those are my three, and why I chose them, broke the rules.
Well, great. Thank you, Chee. That was good. And we'll come back to you soon, and you can we'll all show off some of our new work. We'll get back to you soon. Who's next here? Let's go to Kelli.
Hello, hello. I am going to. I also had a really difficult time picking only three. Helen Soteriadis is, you know, my go-to for everything because she's crazy awesome and perfect in every way. But I didn't choose a highlighter today because I highlight her all the time and, you know, she's just awesome. I chose three others. The first one is Carrie Murphy. I'm going to start trying to share her shot. Let's see. Let's try that again. Okay.
Okay, we see
how
it.
How is that?
It's good.
Does it work like that?
Yes, it's good. I love to see a master with her tools.
How I love my tools. I realized something when I was picking my three, and that is they all have something in common, and that is that they... Oh, wow, slow. They bring me...
Well, hold on a second. We may not see what you want us to see.
I'm going to go back.
Okay.
There. You see that one?
We see five. We see five thumbnails.
Oh no.
Yeah.
Okay, that's no good.
Maybe
I tried to share your desktop. How's that? No.
No.
Still five thumbnails.
No, we still see the five thumbnails.
Shoot.
When you pick a window to share, try sharing your whole desktop. It's the very first option when it says share window. The very first one will be entire desktop.
Let's try that again.
Although we may see something very embarrassing on your desktop.
Oh, hush you.
Who knows what we'll see?
Oh, you wish.
Yeah, totally wish. Okay. We see you. How's that? All right.
Now we see Karen.
Okay.
Yes.
Now you see what I'm seeing.
We see a big white flower, yes.
Awesome. This is Carrie Murphy's flower. What I love about the people that I picked is it's interesting. I chose photographers that move me in a way that I just can't explain. And I tried to put words to it, and I realized that they all have something in common, and that is they all bring me to some sort of alternate reality. It's the world, but not quite the world. It's you know, a parallel world, if you will. And the kind that I would just love to climb into the photo and go there. They all also have a sense of longing in some way. And they never forget. Each one of these photographers I picked also have a sense of whimsy. And this is not only whimsical, but it's, you know, shoots straight to the heart. I am a photographer. And this one kills me. This one, you know, because I don't know if people saw Kerry's post to go with this, but this is something that a lot of us struggle with, and that's calling ourselves photographers. You know, where do you get to the point where you can actually label yourself a photographer? Do you have to have income coming in from it? What is the deal? And that was a pretty moving one. And the next one I have is, I'm not sure exactly how to pronounce his name. I think I got to do a screen share again, right? Let's see.
We lost your screen share.
I know. Oh. I don't have iPhoto, nothing so fancy, you know. So I'm trying again. The next one is Mikko Lagerstedt.
Sounds close enough.
Yeah, all right. You know, nobody is here, nobody from Finland here to argue that point, right? At least not on the show. Now, do you see that?
Yes.
Yes.
You do. Okay. How about that? Better?
No? Yes.
Mikko's photos are pretty stunning. Again, the same thing. There's some sort of sense of longing for me that I feel. They're a little bit dark and sometimes a little bit sad. That's the way I feel when I view these images. And again, reality but not. It's an alternate reality for me.
Oh, I love that one.
Is that a killer?
Yes.
And a sense of whimsy. You know, he has a little fun with his Photoshop, right? He has a little fun with his Photoshop, and he throws things like that in there.
It's cool.
And, you know, even that's just a basic shot okay. Oh, and then the last one I picked, which is so awesome. Okay. I'm going to have to go. He's so great. And he only has about 3,000 plus followers. So, and that's just not right. Do you see that?
Yes.
Ooh. Beautiful.
His name, now I'm gonna try to pronounce this again. He's also from Finland, which is strange. So Ulf Bjolin, that's a wild guess there. But again, a sense of the world, but not quite the world. Something I'd really like to step into. Even a flower he can make seem somewhat a little bit different and dark. And let's see. Whimsical and fun too. He called, I think he titled this Not Angry Birds or something, you know, just for fun. And that's the last one for him. Ulf Bjolin. Okay.
Great.
I'm good.
Well, thanks. Those are great finds. When I saw your suggestions come in, there were two of those people that I had never circled. So I personally thank you, because there's some winners in there. Thank you.
Really?
Yes. Okay. Actually, that's what I feel like. I don't know how you guys feel. I feel like I spend so much time on Google Plus, and then I drill into somebody that maybe I know that it worked from someplace else, and I didn't realize they were on Google Plus, or I just had failed to circle them before. And then I kind of give them this late circle. I kind of limp in at the last second. I feel like, oh, I'm kind of embarrassed that I didn't have him circled earlier. So,
you know, there was another thing. You know, you said photographers for this, and I almost did this anyway. But there's a woman who I believe she does web design. She curates artists and some photographers whose name is Leodor Selenier. It's L-E-O-D-O-R. Oh, my God. The artists that she collects are, you know, on my days when I'm just like, I don't know what to shoot. I go over there and I just start looking at her artists, never mind her photographers, and completely inspired. So I just wanted to throw that in there too.
Good. We'll link her up too so she gets some followers.
Yeah.
Not that followers matter, by the way. Okay. So anyway, let's go to Gordon. Hello, Gordon.
Hey. How are you, Trey?
Good. How's New Zealand? It's the middle of summer.
It's the middle of summer. Obviously, there's a lot of news about the mega upload thing. I believe the latest thing is that we're going to extradite him, but we want you in return.
Yeah, let's trade. Well, it'll be like a Checkpoint Charlie. We could cross at the German border.
Maybe we could use some of those sports cars they kind of they impounded, and you could race across the border like that really fast.
Yeah, I want some of those cars. What are they going to do with those cars? Are they just going to sit there holding, or what?
I don't know. I think most people are more excited by the number plates, actually. That seems to be bigger news today.
Yeah, what were the license plates called? What did they have on
there? Oh, it's all things like mafia and guilty. And this is me doing my gang signs, as you can see. I'm not so good at it, so I'll stop right now.
No, you can't really sell it. Yeah. See that? That's kind of more scary guy. You got to go a little more.
Yeah, that's kind of more like the monster, yeah. Isn't it? That's kind of Nosferatu. I've blown it already, haven't I? I've blown it.
Yeah, no, you got to go sideways with a fake like that. That's how you got to do it.
Hey, that's it. I cannot compete with that.
Gordon, do this. Boy. Just do that. Just do that.
Boy.
Not bad.
That's it. It's a start. Bad.
You sound a little bit too much like the gecko from the Geico commercial saying that.
Oh, not that English muffin again.
All right. Okay, share your finds with us.
Yeah, yeah. Well, like Karen and Kelly were saying, I had great difficulty picking just three. And in fact, one of them, I was going to choose you, Thomas Hawk, because I really like your kind of street style. And I love William Eggleston's work. So, but I figured that everyone had you circled anyway. So I picked three guys who... you may not have come across, so I will start sharing right now. Wait a minute. The window I had open is no longer there.
Oh, no. Well, I will save this moment with breaking news that I'm watching the chat window, and Lotus Carroll has been kicked out of the chat room for saying something a little bit too blue. So I hope she comes back in. I don't know. I missed what she said, but whatever it was, must have upset somebody there.
Wow.
Contain yourselves. I know it's exciting, chat room, but let's keep it civil. A family show here.
Yes.
Okay.
With wine.
Yeah, with language. Wine.
Language. Language, ladies and gentlemen. Language.
Yeah. And Chee, all speak with and Chee, you can start drinking again now that Sergey's gone.
Yeah. You're in a hotel room.
Yeah.
Can we see it? This is the great Todd Sisson, right?
Yes, yes. The first one I wanted to share with you is the great Todd Sisson. He's a New Zealand photographer. This was actually a picture he took during our first Queenstown photo walk. And I'm a big fan of big landscapes. This is actually taken in Queenstown just by the gardens. And I just really, really love his work. In fact, what I thought I'd show you next is, here's a picture of me taking a picture of Todd taking that picture. That's Todd on the left with his tripod getting wet. And on the right, stood up there, is Jason Law, who also does a similar style of photographs. So if you like your big landscape shots, I would highly recommend following Todd Sisson and Jason Law. They're both two of my favorites. This is another one of Todd's. Again, big, big landscapes, often with long exposures, so you've got kind of like the blurring of the water and the big skies. This really says New Zealand, South Island to me, and I really love those landscapes. That's why I moved here. So, and here's another one. This is a fantastic, very, very popularly, very, very commonly photographed tree in Wanaka, which is a town close to Queenstown. But, you know, Todd's really nailed it here. I mean, it's a lovely light, lovely shot. You know, and there's not a lot else I can really say about that. So Todd Sisson for big landscapes. The next one I wanted to share with you is...
Hey, you put that photo in the top 50 spots in New Zealand, right?
Yeah.
I had not seen that, and I put it in my future New Zealand trip. I didn't realize that was one of Todd's, so awesome.
Yeah, although it's a bit like that that church near Lake Tekapo. It's very, very... It's photographed by almost everyone. So
The thing is that I don't think people realize this when they live in a country and there's these famous little like this tree in this lake. Well, no one else has ever heard of this. It might be old hat to you guys, but to outsiders, we don't know about it. And I definitely need to visit that place.
Is Todd Sisson from New Zealand?
Yes,
he is.
Okay.
And for those of us who don't have New Zealand accents or anything other than American accents, he said Jason Law, L-A-W.
Yes.
I don't have a New Zealand accent. I'm from
whatever Britain. It is. We don't really care. It's just not American. So, you know, Law, L-A-W.
L-A-W, yeah. Okay, I'm going to move on to my next Kiwi photographer. This is a picture taken by a good friend of mine called Stefan Haworth. He's also a New Zealander. He's actually from Queenstown. He's a Queenstown local. Now, I'm not sure how well this is coming across. You might need to look at it actually on his stream if you can see lots of water droplets in a big circle. Now, Stefan is really into his lighting. He shot this with two Canon 580 flash guns, one in front and one behind the model. He's got her in one of the many lakes around here, throwing the water around as he fires this picture in complete darkness. And I just love the shape that it's created with the water droplets. It's a beautiful picture. One of the reasons I've chosen Stefan, though, to show you is that he's such an incredibly versatile photographer. And I think that's part of being a professional in a small town, that you have to be able to adapt to different jobs, but also, you know, a demonstration of his excellence as a photographer. So he does these great portraits and really interesting lighting shots. But then he'll do these amazing action shots as well. This is where I first kind of came across him, when he was shooting mountain biking and snowboarding. This is actually just outside of Queenstown. That's Lake Wakatipu, the main lake around Queenstown in the background. And he's some distance away here shooting this mountain biker, literally heading towards the edge of this cliff and certain doom. God. And this picture was featured in a biking magazine here. So, you know, I really love that. Mountain biking is huge in Queenstown at the moment. So if any of you are really into that, we've got some fantastic parks here. And the last picture I wanted to show you by Stefan is a really cute one. Again, it shows his love of lighting, but also love of fun. This is his dog last year in the snow.
It's so cute.
I just love the look on the dog's face. It's really great.
It's great.
You can't tell where the snow stops and the dog starts.
Oh, that is one happy dog.
Yeah. Now, my third photographer I wanted to share with you is a German called Klaus-Peter Kubik. Unlike the first two, I've never met him. I've not even spoken to him, but I love his style of photography. Let me find... Here we go. Now, he's really, obviously, as you'll see here, he's really into architecture, and I love architectural photography. Mm-hmm. I love the geometry, the straight lines, the angles. And as you see, a lot of things that he does here... To kind of really accentuate those shapes is to either use long exposures or some filters on the sky so the actual foreground subjects really stand out. And I think if anyone's ever tried to do architecture photography, you might think, well, if you've not tried it, you might think, hey, it's pretty easy, just take a picture of a building, right? But for me, one of the challenges is, one of the things I really enjoy is the technical kind of geometry and perfection of it, that when you look at these lines, they're absolutely straight. You know, the symmetry is perfect and everything is just lined up perfectly. Here's another one. you know, it's just looking up at some buildings. But again, I love the arrangement of the buildings here and the blank space. Again, Thomas has taken a couple of pictures like this as well that I really, really love. I love this kind of style.
I think we call that architectural upskirt, Gordon.
Do you get a little slap from the security guard afterwards, Thomas?
Sometimes you do.
Is he feeling lucky? He doesn't just shoot black and white. This is obviously a color picture. But again, I love the kind of organic nature of this and the shapes. And I'm not sure if we'll have time for this later, but Trey asked us to maybe show some of our own pictures. And some of the ones that I'd like to share with you are kind of influenced by all of those three photographers that I showed you. I took them before meeting them, but they're very kind of, you can see why I like these photographers, because they're the kind of style of pictures that I also like taking myself.
Cool. Well, thank you. Thank you, Gordon. All right, that was fun. Okay, now we'll show off some of our own recent work, and we could talk about it a little bit. We'll start with Thomas, and let's see what you have, Thomas.
Okay, hold on. Let me share the screen.
Okay.
Why is this not working? Here, why don't you go to somebody else while I get my screen set up here?
Okay, I'll pinch it here.
Okay, you go first.
Okay. So here's some photos I've never shown anybody. I'll roll these into the blog. Every day I put up a new photo on the blog, and then I share those also to Google Plus and all over the place. So these are new ones. I'll just share my iPhoto. Okay. So here's one. This is in the Andes. This was this super remote lake that took a lot of hiking to get to. Wow. I think this is about 30 kilometers into a hike. And these are the kind of places that you see from planes, you know, and you look down, you think, oh, I wonder what it'd be like to stand there, you know. But you never see anyone around it. You never see any roads. You think, oh, it was just impossible to get there. Well, this is one of those just impossible spots. And I camped here for several days and waited for things to get just right. Anyway.
Were you by yourself?
No. I had some people there with me. And I don't know if you can see this or not. Let me zoom in. This is a glacier here. To kind of give you a sense of scale.
Oh my God.
So you
can
see how big this is. Okay, so that's that. Here's one. This is in Paris. This is a place that nobody ever goes to because everyone goes to the hot spots in Paris. But this is the sort of Jules Verne type museum on natural history and evolution. And this photo is, of course, incredibly busy. And usually I am against busy photos, but the photo is, of course, about the busyness. By the way, I don't really like to overanalyze my own photos, so I'll try not to do that. But what's cool here, and what I like with a lot of these photos, is you can zoom in and see all kinds of details. Because it's all taken with a 24-megapixel camera. And not that zooming in to 100% is always important or anything, but it is interesting, I think.
So what is the lens?
What is the what?
Lens.
Oh, the lens. This is a 14 to 24 lens in this case. And also, you know, there's a lot of photo nerds out there that hate slanted lines. Whenever you take a wide angle lens and aim it down or up, you end up getting slanted lines. I like the slanted lines. I think they're cool.
Me too.
And my brain and eyes adjust. And so I just ignore those people.
Block them. Block them.
Here's one. This is from the new Google offices in Los Angeles. They have these awesome new offices down. It's inside I think it's a Frank Gehry building. And this is the, kind of their hallway of Google Doodles. And it's just a beautiful idea. And I set up in here just to take this kind of shot. And I didn't really have this idea until the post-processing came in. Okay, so that's that. And here's the last one I'll share. I thought this was kind of a nice romantic scene, a little cafe in the this is up in the Alps in Switzerland, a little mountain town called Zermatt, which is probably it's got to be one of the top three mountain towns in the world. You know, you think about going out at night in the wet streets and it's cold and you're all bundled up and you're going to a nice warm restaurant. You stay there too late and then you walk home, and I don't know. It just feels nice to me. Anyway, that is my fourth photo to share.
Those are great. Love them. Screen. Love all the colors.
Oh, well, thanks, Karen.
Yep.
Okay, I think I got it now, Trey. You want me to go next?
Okay, yes, go. You are also a broadcast professional like me, so go for it.
Okay.
Wow.
So these are four photographs that I chose to share.
Cool.
This first one is actually, it looks a little bit like some sort of futuristic landscape or planet. But actually what it is a photograph of a macro that I used on the edge of a sculpture at the de Young Museum. And So a lot of times I like to create an entirely new scene out of something that's not intended. And so this is just like the edge of a sculpture, and then I'm shooting through glass, and there's some light in the background that's lighting the sculpture. And so I try to create sort of like this artificial sunset on this plateau on another planet. And I love macro photography. Yeah, I love macro photography because you can just do creative things with it that, you know, it's not even really, you know, intended. But you can just use your imagination. So that's the first one I wanted to share. This next one, I've been playing around more with different processing techniques. And this is a beautiful church in St. Louis that I went and saw. I think it's St. Xavier's Church or something like that. But and it was a dramatic ceiling on its own, obviously with this long sort of hallway and these interesting lines and architecture. But I did a lot of processing on it, and I gave it this sort of mirrored, dreamy, blurred effect because I just wanted to create a new piece with it, and I wanted to do something a little bit different and less traditional than just a standard church shot. And so I kind of wanted to make it feel almost like you were in the church in a dream. So that's a shot I took in St. Louis. These last two shots are shots that I just took in Detroit just recently, 2 weeks ago. So this first one, this is in a place called the Boblo Docks, where I shared Lotus's picture of the sunrise earlier. This is down in the pump room or some sort of mechanical room, and I have no idea what these things are, but inside of one of these big tubes was a can of Stella Artois beer, and so I used the fisheye, and I love this new fisheye. Gordon, you and I talked about this before I got it, and I almost didn't buy it, and I'm just so glad that I did, because for particularly a circular shot like this, I just think, because on the full frame sensor, it's a complete circle. This lens makes a complete circle. So I square crop them for the most part, but I thought it worked really well with this sort of fisheye and looking down this tube, and then you have the beer right there in the center.
Thomas, you must have been about 2 centimeters away from the can. How far were you?
Yeah. Yeah, no, I was. I was very close. I had to be maybe 2 inches from the edge of the thing there. You could see those bolts that are kind of sticking out. I think those were about 2 inches long. So I'm very close. And then another one of the buildings that we shot was this building called Farwell, which is an old abandoned office building in Detroit. And this is three different levels, three stories of Farwell. Different office rooms, and what's gone on here is a lot of the graffiti artists have painted the windows so that you can see them from the outside, and they've used different color paints to paint, you know, letters and things on the actual glass on the windows, and so that had the effect of when the light was coming in of sort of colorizing this light through these spray painted windows. And I thought it was very interesting, and it was a beautiful building. We probably shot it for 3 hours, and I just really love the way that the light comes into abandoned buildings sometimes.
Can I ask you again what lens you used?
This lens was also the 8-15 fisheye. So I've probably been overusing that lens a little bit, but this one was not on the 8mm. It's not the perfect circle. I think I had it out to probably like 10 millimeters or something. And then I cropped it, of course. So, but I love shooting abandoned stuff, and, you know, I always find interesting sort of elements to dying buildings and stuff like that. And obviously Detroit is so full of that stuff. So anyways, so there are some of my photos.
Beautiful.
All right. Thank you. Those are great. That first one, I mean, they're all good. That first one was just insane.
Yeah.
I think you ought to, you know, Thomas, you post so many photos, and they're all interesting, of course. But do you have like a top 20?
I don't think I do.
You should, because it's inscrutable to people like me, because I do like seeing your photos, but man, I would love to see what you think your top 20 are. That would just that'd be,
you know,
great.
Trey, the hard thing with that, and people ask me about favorites and stuff like that all the time, and the line I give them is, you know, that Joni Mitchell says songs are like children, and it's like, you know, how do you pick a favorite? I just have a hard time. I mean, even picking four here for this show is difficult for me.
Yeah. Not to mention, you get in different moods, and then other, you know, one week you like this 10, and next week you like that 10, and
I know. I think I need to hire you as my editor or something. You know.
Because
yeah.
Trey's favorites, not yours.
It works cheap.
All right, Kelli, let's share yours. I'm on your screen now. Over.
Okay. You can see what I've got up there then. Not me. Hopefully.
Yes.
Well, I chose to go with this one because this is my oldest son, and it's his birthday today. So I shot this weekend, and it was kind of a bummer because we had planned on doing something, you know, driving and doing something special with a friend, and then the snow came, and it was a really lame amount of snow, but just enough to make it so we couldn't go. So this was from a playground and totally not what he had planned, but he was still a good spirit and posed for me. He's awesome like that. This is just my usual. What I like to do, like Thomas said, you know, macros, you know, really change your perspective. It's a completely different, you know, view on the world, and I really totally dig macros, so that was something I took this weekend. And we had snow and ice, so I just happened to be walking in the house yesterday, and it was just after being at the neighbor's house trying to get a water drop shot off their tree. And I wasn't on their property, but he happened to come home at the time I was there, and he just moved there, and he owns a security, you know, business. And he was just so insulted that I was taking photographs of his property. And it was really awkward. And all I said was, "Hi, nice to meet you." And he didn't even say hello to me.
Oh my God.
He just went inside his house. And, you know, I'm sure, you know, he's going to train his video cameras on me going forward. But anyway, as I was walking in the house, trying not to, you know, be too mortified, I found that on my patio. And this again was from the playground. We got snow, but that's about as much snow as we got right there. Just a really pathetic amount. And so that's what I did with that. And I think that's it. Oh, yeah, that's something I'm supposed to get there. We don't need
cool. Well, thank you. Thank you, Kelli. Hey, I want everyone in the chat room to know. Here, I'll share my chat room screen. We're watching everything. At least I am. I think most of us are in here.
Yes.
And so, you know, if you guys have any questions, Dave is keeping track of the questions because we have Q&A upcoming quickly here. So thank you guys in the chat room. Hello, hello, hello. They're all waving. We're awesome.
We're okay.
All yeah, right, you know, so...
The funny thing there is that...
What did you say, Gordon?
The funny thing there is you saw Stefan's picture of his dog scroll up there. I was talking to Stefan just before I came on. I said, Stefan, I'm going to show you a picture of the dog. He's like, no, show a picture of like a snowboarder or a model. And I was like, they'll love the dog. Everyone will love the dog.
Yeah, dogs are always winners. Are you next, Gordon?
I can go if you want me to.
Yes, please do.
Okay. Let's see if I can get this to work again. So I want you to shout as soon as you can see a photo on my screen. Not my desktop, but natural photo.
Yes.
Cool. We're in business. Okay. This is the first picture I wanted to show you. This is one of my favorite pictures, and I took it with a Mamiya 7.2. Yes, shot Caro, film camera. And not even an SLR film camera, medium format film camera, a rangefinder. And this camera had some amazing lenses. This was taken with a 43mm lens that, on that size film, is like equivalent to 20 or 17 mil. It's a very wide-angle shot. And I found this camera incredibly infuriating to use because I could never get it lined up right. I couldn't get any of those nice architecture shots. So instead, I went looking for more kind of organic shapes where there was no definite horizon because they were always squint. But this is where it kind of worked for me. This is Lower Antelope Canyon, which is near Page in Utah, I believe, which is one of my favorite. I love all the national parks around there. Southwest USA is one of my favorite places to shoot. And the nice thing, the thing I'd say about this picture is that everyone says it's a very, it's, everyone takes pictures in Lower Antelope Canyon. You've got those amazing beams of sunlight that come through the top and you get these ace colors. But that's in summer, the height of summer when the sun is overhead. Now, I was there in the depth of winter and you don't get any of that light. But for me, I still love this picture. So I think a lot of places are very famous for visiting at certain times of year, but you shouldn't avoid them at other times of year because, you know, there was no one in there. I've heard from people who literally, there's people everywhere, you know, in this canyon. But when I went, there were only two people there. So, you know, it's quite nice to have it to yourself. Whoops. You've seen these. I can't take credit for those. This is my shot. So that was my landscape shot inspired by Todd, or which inspired me to recommend Todd. And this is my shot that inspired me to recommend Stefan. I took it in just winter, just gone in New Zealand, just at the end, at an event at Snow Park, which is one of the ski resorts nearby to Queenstown. This is Jossie Wells, who is a Wanaka lad, who is, I believe, the world champion free skier, or certainly he's right up there. And he was doing these amazing tricks, and I really wanted to do one of these composite pictures. I had no idea how. So Stefan was stood right next to me. He basically told me exactly how to do it. If you want that starburst on the sun, you basically close the aperture right down. I shot this at about f/22. This was with the Canon 17-40, by the way. And the copy I was using was a bit, it had some marks on the front element, and you can see those on the flare on the sun. It's not that nice. I was shooting with a 1D Mark IV at, I think, 10 frames a second, or maybe 7 frames a second. And this was just, I never process any of my pictures, but this was obviously layered in Photoshop. And if you've never taken this kind of picture before, it's actually really easy, especially if the athlete is going in front of a plain background like a blue sky. It's very easy to composite them together. Because I test cameras for a living, but I'm terrible at doing processing. I try and do everything in camera, so this is the barest minimum. So I was quite pleased with that. What else have I got? Yeah. I showed you some architecture shots earlier. This is one of my own architecture shots. This is inside City Hall in London on the South Bank. If you've ever seen that building, it looks a bit like a motorcycle helmet from the outside. It's very close to Tower Bridge. And there's a fantastic event that London has. I believe it's every year. It's called the Open Day or Open Home. And what happens is a lot of buildings that you would not normally have any access to, government buildings, big banks, that sort of thing, skyscrapers, they open up for a day or for a weekend, and you're just allowed to go in. And places where normally security guards would be pushing you away and breaking your camera, they just welcome you in with all your equipment. And it's fantastic. If any of you are visiting London, try and do it around with this Open Day event. I don't know if it's still happening. I've not been there for 5 years, but it was around September, as I recall. Anyways, this was inside City Hall, and this again was shot with that same lens as the Antelope Canyon. So this is medium format. Again, film. And I have just one more picture to show you. I thought I'd better show you a digital picture as well. This is a comet. This is one of my other passions, which is astrophotography or long exposure work. This was a comet McNaught, which was very faint in the northern hemisphere, but by the time it got down here, it was like, I'm going to really put on a big show here. And this was the biggest, brightest comet I've ever seen. I shot this on a full-frame Canon with an 85mm 1.8 lens. And that lens is such a winner. It's one of Canon's best lenses, one of their oldest EF mount lenses. But it's an absolute classic. It's very well corrected. And when you're taking pictures of stars with the aperture almost open or wide open, you really notice poor quality lenses in the corners. But this one works out. In fact, I'll have a little closer look at that so you can see some of those star images. They're not perfect, but they're pretty good. When you look right at the edge of the image, they are dots, which is what you want. This is about, as I recall, about a 3 or 4 minute exposure at about 400 ISO. And normally on an exposure like that, the stars would move as a reflection of the Earth rotating. So this was on a tracked mount. This is on a little special tripod that basically turns around once every 24 hours. So it counteracts the rotation of the Earth so you can do long exposures. So that was... That's my other passion, is long exposure stuff. I don't get to do enough of it, but when you get the chance, it is good fun. And this was just with a normal lens. This proves you don't need a telescope or anything too bizarre, just a normal 85 1.8.
Wow.
Cool. Thanks, Gordon. So, you know, people in chat room love you, Gordon, of course. And if you like Gordon, he's got this, quirky, cute personality or whatever. I don't know how to say it, but... But he's this likable guy, right? And so you get this when you're on his website, which is sort of a, camera review sites are usually fairly stolid affairs. But he has a nice voice there. And I think I'm going to try to convince you, Gordon, when we're hanging out in New Zealand, to kind of brand it more with your own self, like put your little head there kind of tilted right by the logo or something. Because it is you. Your voice is there.
Well, thank you. Thank you. This is great fun. We love our hobbies so much. And for years, I wrote for magazines, and we were always told to write in the third person. It was always, we think this, our opinion is this. And I started doing that when I launched Camera Labs. I was writing the third person the whole time. And then I thought, wait a minute, it's a one-man operation. It's just me. Why am I doing the royal we? Why am I saying we and our opinion is this? And we thought this. Forget it. I'm going to make it I and me, and I kind of only started doing that about a year ago, but hopefully it's not annoying anyone too much. But I quite kind of like coming out in that respect.
Hey, Gordon, go ahead and unbutton a couple buttons on that shirt for Trey.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's getting late.
Doing a little bit of
we just need the disco lights now.
There we go.
We got to have a hot one.
Those, Kelly, they're already in place.
Yeah, he also has a mirror above his bed that says some objects may be larger than they appear.
Trey, you would know that, Trey.
Yeah, well.
Thank you, Thomas.
It's his object he's referring to, Thomas.
All right, Karen, you will bring up the rear, so to speak.
Whoa. What about tea?
Oh, no. Okay, yeah, let's do Chi and then you. I'm sorry.
If I'm going to truly bring up the rear, then Chi has to go first.
Okay.
Okay. Mine will be pretty quick. See this one? So this is Pike Place. I took it a couple of months ago. It was a really cold, blustery day. The sun had just gone down. And I really never do sort of wet, rainy photography, and I thought I'd give it a try. I took probably like 70 or 80 shots, just playing around, experimenting, and got a set of three that I did HDR on, trying to make this one. But I was just learning a lot and had a whole lot of fun just shooting and like having lots of mistakes, but no, I just had a blast there shooting that one.
Awesome.
This is actually also a couple months ago. This is in Maui, right by Mama's Fish Cafe, a really wonderful restaurant in Maui.
I want your travel schedule.
Yeah, this is a really fun trip. I went there with my wife.
a lot of people know this, part of the Google Plus team went to Hawaii, and so this is that trip. The sun was going down, and I thought I'd give it a shot. I happened to bring my camera along, no tripod, so this is handheld. This is actually five shots, HDR'd into one, handheld, and very low light. So this one also, I took probably like 20 shots in order to get a set of five that was reasonable. So that was fun. This one, so this is a while ago, back in 2003. I took my son to Africa with us on a safari, and he was the youngest person that he was five years old at the time. He was the youngest one that these guys had ever taken on safari and taken through this Maasai village. And the Maasai village, they were all used to adult tourists going through, but the kids were kind of fascinated by seeing another five-year-old there. So this little boy there, kind of squinting at us, is like, "Really? You brought a five-year-old boy with you?" And so it's kind of an interesting expression, and I was lucky to catch that. And then, this is kind of my favorite picture from the safari. Completely, just lucky. We were driving along, all of a sudden said, like, "Stop, lions!" And then these three cubs, when we stopped, they were standing up, and then one sat down, another sat down, and then the third one in the middle like made a little triangle, and then eventually that one sat down, and I was like so amazed. I didn't look at my camera. I didn't know what I was doing, and I just like sat there and I just shot, and afterwards they were way too dark because this is in a shadow in very bright sunlight, really, really bright sunlight. This is in the shadow, so the like this area was way too dark. After being inspired by Trey's thing about overexposure on the shuttle launch, I went back about a month ago and sort of took another swack at like processing this one and came out with this result. So
wow,
those are my four.
Impressive. Great.
Yeah. Wonderful. That's cool. Thank you, Chi. Okay, now, Karen, no. I'm sorry.
It was, yeah, now. Really, really, Trey, honestly. rearbringing.com. You say share the desktop, right?
Do not go to that website, anybody.
Whatever you do.
Not safe for work.
I'm going to see. I think this is the one I really want to share. Now, you tell me if you can see this. Is that a yes or a no?
Yes.
Yes. Beautiful.
So this is one I've been working on. It was from the summer, and one of our crazy, crazy cloud sunsets that we get around here, and I just kind of liked it. So I have to, when nature sometimes presents me with such amazing scenes, I really have to resist messing with it too much, but I was messing with it a little bit today. This is one, this is the road. We went the back way to Bodie one day, and I had to stop in the middle of the road because Thomas Hawk does, and, you know, so I have to. But the clouds are just so amazing. So Mono Lake is to your left, and then Bodie is, like, to your right, but a little further on. But I just, the Eastern Sierras are just so amazing to me. And I just love the clouds and the colors.
Gorgeous.
And that's a pelican.
Ooh, pretty.
That's right.
We get pelicans in our pondage every summer, but they only stay for like 3 weeks, and they're huge and they swim really fast. You can sort of see his what do you call it? Not wake, when he cuts water right here in the front there, where his neck hits the water. They're so fast. They're so graceful in the water, but they are so fast. They just like motor, and they're really, really shy and they don't like people. So I had to sit really quiet, and I felt like they bestowed their presence upon me that day. So that was how it felt. I love my black and white. I have to return to my roots sometimes, so to speak. So there are some roots to return to. And that was actually down in Yosemite, Trey. Oh. That was our walk along the... We shot and shot and shot and shot, and I just... I don't know. Sometimes I shoot and it sucks. doesn't matter what I do, it sucks. And then I just get annoyed. So, but we were still stuck out there because, you know, everybody else was shooting and liking what they were doing. So I started shooting some of the more micro things that I see, and that was one of them. So I kind of like that. And I know you said four, but I had this too, which is Trey with Thomas's fisheye lens in that crazy tunnel. I just thought I'd share that.
We don't see it.
Oh, you don't see that?
There we see it now.
Okay.
Yeah. It just took a second.
Nice.
Delay. Yeah, so a little Trey Ratcliffe in the tunnel action with cars coming. And
I like that shadow on him from the car's headlight that's about to hit him.
I know. Isn't that cool?
Yeah.
I know. It's awesome.
All right. Well, thanks.
Okay, I unshared that screen. Sorry.
No problem. Thank you. Thank you, Karen.
Absolutely.
Good photo, too. You have another group shot of all of us, too, there.
Yeah, that I have that, too. You want to see it?
Yeah, share that one, too.
Let me go back there again, then. Boom.
And then we'll get to Q&A. Dave's been collecting questions here, so I'm just about to read through them.
I don't know. It's not that one. It's that one. Probably took a second.
There's Thomas.
Awesome. That was before we all got hit by a car, and then we came back as photographers in this next lifetime.
Sweet.
We are amazing that way.
Yeah. You know, by the way, we all do these photo walks. I know Thomas leads them, and I think a lot of other people do too. And as far as I know, they're always free, and everyone's invited. We're going to be doing a lot more of them. I've got one coming up in L.A. with Tom Anderson, and then Hawaii. And then we're going to do them, you know, everywhere. I'm sure Thomas has them coming up. So just stay tuned if you want to join us for these things. Everyone is invited, and they're always great little celebrations of photography. Do you have any coming up, Thomas?
Well, the next thing that I think we've got scheduled coming up is Jarvie's thing in March in Utah.
Yeah, that could
just
be cool.
A weekend away, but I don't have anything scheduled right now, but I'm sure something will come up.
Hey, Thomas, can you do one in early April? I'll be in San Francisco for a couple of weeks.
Oh, definitely, Gordon, for sure.
I'll come down the mountain.
Let's do it. We'll line it up. Let me know when you're coming. We'll do a big one.
We'll do.
Cool. There's a big one next week in New York at the massive Hurl. I think there's like 60 people scheduled to hurl and do a photo walk.
Nice. Wow. And we're doing one when Cassius comes into town. I think that's May or something, on his little train tour. Cassius Wright is
excellent. All right, so let me pour through the questions here, see what we can find. Here's one from the mysteriously named Web3591. It says, question for Trey. Why do you go to Burning Man? I go to Burning Man. I didn't really know why I went the very first time. It's kind of like I didn't really know why I ended up reading The Name of the Wind. I think for whatever reason, because I'm, you know, open about my art and I share everything, that I end up just getting so many suggestions because people come to know me through my art or how I share or whatever. And they say, hey, Trey, you know, I really think you would like this. It's sort of like a proactive Amazon product suggestion list. And so many people recommended that I read, like, The Name of the Wind, and I read it, and I loved it. They were right. I also had so many people say, Trey, you got to go to Burning Man. You would love it. So I thought, I don't know. I mean, aren't there just a bunch of druggies and hippies? And just crap. I mean, that's not really my scene, right? But I went, and they were right. And so this is the reason that I go, is because, you know, there's so many places in the world you can go to spend your time. And when you go to a location, you generally know what you're going to see, what's going to be awesome about it. You know, if you go to Paris or whatever, you know, you're going to see the Eiffel Tower and the Louvre and these sorts of things. You go to Burning Man, you don't know what you're going to see, but it's going to be awesome. And it's going to be stimulating in a unexpected way. I need constant visual stimulation, and I need to be inspired. This is something I know about myself. And when you go there, you see things that you just never expected to see in your life, and it kind of really unleashes sort of another creative side of you that you didn't know that you had. You have to go into it with the right mindset. You know, like anything in life, attitude is half the battle. and you can generally control your attitude about these things. So anyway, that's why I go to Burning Man. And Thomas, you're going to come this year. I think there's a lot of people from Google Plus coming, right?
Yeah, I'm looking forward to Burning Man this year. It should be great. It's a great time. So the big crowd of people are coming.
You know what we got to do is let's lobby Natalie and other people at Google to do like a Google Plus camp, right? It can't be officially branded Google Plus or anything, but we should get like a great big area because there's so many new people that are going that are kind of scared or don't really know. But we could have this huge camp of people that are all newbies, probably mostly photographers, and maybe we get Google to like bring in a satellite truck or something so we can connect and share our photos. And,
that sounds good. And you and Vic Gundotra are going to be rooming together this year, right? In your tent?
Yeah, we're going to be sharing a bunk bed, and we'll have to get up in the middle of the night with our pajamas with the flaps on the bottom.
I like that.
Three Stooges.
Bringing up the rear.
All right. What's the next question? Kelly, here's a question for you.
Uh-oh.
Are you ready?
I'm ready.
I'm putting you on the spot here. This is from Raul Inc. He sounds Latin. Kelly, what macro lens do you recommend?
I'll tell you what I use. I use the Canon 100 millimeter 1 or 2.8. It's the L series one. See, I don't even know. 2.8, I think. it's crazy awesome. That's really all I have to say about that. Gordon, which one do I use? It's that one, right?
It's the 100 2.8L.
Thank you.
I think.
That's the one I use.
That's the best macro lens for Canon, I think.
Okay, so.
Cool.
We all agree that's the most awesome one.
Yes.
All right, next question. Let me see here. This is from Corey Teague. He says, is there any way to take an entire album from Facebook and transfer it to Google Plus? I know the answer, but I'm sure you do too, Thomas. Go ahead, Thomas.
Well, I don't think you really can. I mean, Facebook's kind of closed. You know, I don't think they really want you doing stuff like that. I think Facebook would rather Google Plus never existed, you know.
Wait a minute. Dave is coming in with a – he just sent a link. Tell us, Dave, what's going on.
Dave has a hack.
Go ahead.
I was muted. There's an extension called Move Your Photos on Google Chrome that supposedly will move your photos from Facebook to Google's Picasa, which will in turn end up in your G Plus account.
Cool. I'm sharing Chee's screen now. He's showing it.
Oh.
Oh, well, maybe there is a way. See what I know?
So we don't know how long this will last. Because Facebook can shut it down or something. But
oh, come on, Chee. Why would they want to do that?
But you have nothing to lose.
Amanjan.com for writing it.
Okay, let's see up there.
Hmm. Cool. Okay. Here's another question. Maybe this will be the last question we answer, and then we'll... No, actually, there's so many. I'll try to pick a few. There's too many, but I'll pick some. Okay, so what – this is from Josh Armour, spelled with a British spelling with a U stuck in there for style.
The correct spelling, Trev.
So he asks, what lens is the best first non-kit lens, macro, wide-angle, or long zoom? I'll give a quick answer, then Gordon, maybe you can chime in. But it depends, of course, what you're into. I love landscape photography. And if I were to start all over with a new camera, and if I was getting one lens, I would get a wide-angle lens. I love my Nikon 14-24, although that's a very expensive lens. I think the Tokina lens is very serviceable and just a fraction of the price. Sigma also has a very inexpensive wide-angle lens. And if you're just getting into photography, chances are that you've never actually looked through a wide-angle lens. And once you do it the first time, you'll never forget it. It's wild. It's really exciting. And anyway, so if you're into landscapes, that's the first lens you should get. If you're into portraits, something else.
can I ask you what is considered like wide angle, not ultra wide angle, but just wide angle?
Well, I would say a wide angle lens is anything maybe wider than 28 millimeter. Is there any kind of official definition?
I think Gordon? 28. I think 28 is officially wide angle. This is obviously 28 equivalent on the full frame. So technically speaking, most kit lenses start at an equivalent of 28, so they are technically wide lenses. I think anything wider than 28 is becoming ultra wide. I mean, 24 is my favorite focal length. But in answer to the question, it obviously depends what kind of pictures you want to take. And the great thing about having a lens already is the way you decide what your second lens should be is to think about how your existing one is limiting you. When you're zooming in, do you think, oh, I wish you could zoom in a bit further? Then get a telephoto lens. If you're zooming out and you think, oh, I wish you could zoom wider, get a wide angle. If you're trying to focus close to something and it's just not focusing, get a macro lens. And if you want to take portraits with a nice blurred background, which I think a lot of people do, then, you know, and I've seen it coming up on the chat just constantly. Everyone shouted, 50mm 1.8, 50mm 1.8. And there's a reason why they're shouting it, because, you know, Nikon and Canon and everyone else does fantastic value 50mm 1.8 lenses. They're very cheap. You can get that great portrait effect. They become 75 to 80 millimeter when you put them on a typical DSLR, which is perfect for portraits. And you'll get such great pictures. The other nice thing about them is that they're fixed in focal length, which forces you to move around, whereas zooms, I find, maybe I'm lazy, but what I find is as soon as I have a zoom lens, my feet become glued to the floor, and I just zoom in and out. God forbid I actually walk towards or further away from the subject or crouch down. You know, you just zoom in and out. So you get a fixed lens, you move around. I'm just going to, in case I don't get another opportunity to say this, I want to issue an apology to everyone in Arizona for saying that Paige is in Utah. It is, of course, in Arizona. I just get so caught up in the landscapes there. It's all beautiful there, but apologies if anyone was offended by that. Two of my favorite states, obviously. 50mm 1.8.
Well, Gordon, I would have to disagree. For the first prime, I would probably recommend people go with the Canon 1200mm f5.6 lens.
That's my second choice.
Of course, Gordon laughs at that one. That's a monster lens.
Can I throw a different perspective on it?
My favorite prime is the 135 f2. I think that'd be the first one I'd buy, personally. But
it's one of their best, one of their sharpest lenses.
It is. But the 50 does make sense. The 50 and the 50 f1.4, I think, particularly with Canon, is a very good value. The f8.
Yeah, I think it's worth spending the extra on it because you get the USM focusing, you get a nice smooth manual focusing ring, and that's important also if you want to pull focus when you're filming video, because the 1.8 manual focusing is a bit scratchy. It doesn't matter that much if you're auto-focusing and you're not doing video, but if you are, it's nice to have that smooth manual focusing ring.
So if I could throw another perspective on it, the first lens I got after my kit lenses was, and I actually just bought another one, is the Nikon 18-200 VR2. And it's a sort of a all-around walking lens, great for like kids and family as well as travel. And it's not necessarily the best lens in the world, like, because it's sort of an all-purpose thing. But I find that I just take a ton more photos with it, and I'm willing to experiment more because I don't hassle with bringing a whole bunch of. I can just grab it and go when the kids are running out the door. I have like a specialty lens. I have the 70-200 like 2.8. lens as well, but I just use this one so much more, and I've come to really appreciate, like, for someone who's just an amateur, like, just being able to grab and go and take so many pictures of it, that's helped me so much.
Yeah, that's good advice. Okay, let's go through the questions here. Thomas, maybe you can speak to this. I will too. I get these a lot, and I'm sure you do too. Actually, there's two questions in here that are kind of the same. Gary Monroe says, what does a photographer have to do to get your attention? Trey, and then there's another one here that says, I can't find it here. I'm sorry. Zach C. says, There were a few on the subject, but how do photographers grab your attention of you all? I'm not looking for followers, but Trey says brutal honesty would be so constructive. So, you know, I am kind of an edge case. I'm just going to share my screen here just to show how kind of what's going on here. Let me share my here we go. Let me share the Google Docs. And then let me go to see this one. So, like, this example is my, like, my face. I get messages everywhere, just like I'm sure Thomas does and a lot of other people do. I am completely overwhelmed. I have just tens of thousands of unanswered emails. And I feel awful because people ask me questions. Like, this is just, like, January 18th. And I don't, you know, some of these people I actually know. I was just looking at this. It says, this is from Jordan Naylor. You used my phone to call your wife and you got back from China. So I actually know this guy. I had to email him back. I just don't have time. Look, there's even a – I don't even have time to email back cute girls.
Whoa.
I know. So
priorities, my friend.
So, you know, that's just Facebook. And so I feel really bad because people do take a lot of time and they send me long emails. They ask very thoughtful questions. And they put – I have threads all over the place. It's overwhelming. But let me just say, and maybe Thomas would agree, is that you don't really need my attention. My attention isn't really worth that much. I try to do these hangouts as much as I can and promote other people and mention as many other people as possible. But you don't really need my approval. You don't really need my critiques. You know, I'm just a guy. There's a lot of other people that can give you good critiques. But just know that I am sorry that I can't be there for everybody. I wish I could replicate myself. I can't bring myself to have one of my employees email you back and pretend to be me. That doesn't seem right. So these things just sit there unanswered. I don't know what to do. Thomas, what do you do when people are really trying to get your attention?
I get kind of the same problem. I mean, between everything that you get, whether it's email, Facebook mail, Google messages to your profile, or, you know, plus even more, you know, plus Thomas Hawk mentions, you know, you just get so much that it's impossible, you know, Flickr mail. There's just so much stuff that comes through. But, you know, I don't know, Trey, I just cherry pick some of the stuff out sometimes and respond, but that's not so helpful. You know, I think the thing that gets my attention the most is when I see people leave articulate, intelligent comments, particularly on Google Plus, because that's where I spend my time. So when I see someone that writes a thoughtful comment, you know, oftentimes, and not just on my stuff, I mean on other people's stuff. Like, I found a lot of great people to follow on Google Plus. Like, I might be looking at Kelly's stream, and I see, oh, well, who is this person that's, like, talking about the wolf pack or something like that with Kelly? You know, or what is this going on? But I think it's the interaction that you see people online interacting, and the comments, I think, are a huge thing. So I would encourage somebody, if they wanted to get more involved with the community, to find some people that they admire, and again, not just me, I mean other people, it's probably even better, and leave some thoughtful, intelligent comments on their work and get to know them.
Yeah,
I know. I do the same thing. A lot of times people just come by and, you know, say, oh, I like your picture or whatever. But sometimes, like, I've gotten into a conversation with a kid over in, I think he's in Bosnia, actually, and he's a wonderful photographer and with an art student, you know, has a degree in art. And he was just leaving, I don't know, just thoughtful comments about photos. And so we've been talking art and photos and, you know, stuff like that back and forth. It's amazing. I mean, I don't know where else you'd ever get a chance to do that, but it's an amazing thing. But you do have to sort of, those thoughtful ones sort of stand out, I find.
Like, so Trey, I mean, you read your comments on your photos on Google Plus, right?
Yeah, I do. I read every one of them.
Yeah.
Me too, and
I think I read about 75% of my Plus mentions.
Yeah, I mean, I think that's a good place to start. People can leave comments, but, you know, if it's just nice picture, they're not going to stand out. But if somebody actually takes some time and, you know, makes a connection there, you know, I may end up adding them as a contact.
Yeah. Yeah.
If they don't watermark and all that other bad stuff.
Now, you know, Thomas, I showed you some beautiful photos tonight that were watermarked.
I know you did. I know.
But I'm with you on the watermarks. I generally don't like them, but I'll excuse it in the case of an amazing photo. Okay, anyway, let's one more question. This one is kind of for Gordon, although anyone can jump in. This is from Zach C. He says, I have a lazy question for Gordon. Could he name a mid-range Nikon, which Gordon would call a Nikon, with a five-shot bracketing ability? I would rather keep my D70S and manually do a three-shot bracket, even though I may end up doing close to seven shots.
Well, it's an impossible one to answer if all you want to buy is a body, because they don't do one, a mid-range body with more than three frames, as I recall. Correct me if I'm wrong. The D300S, I think, is the cheapest model in the range that offers more than three-frame bracketing. And obviously, that's getting on now. Hopefully, there'll be a D400 soon. But in the meantime, a D300S, you know, because it's a few years old, you might get a great price on that. And it's, you know, it's a lovely camera. It's very tough. It's fast. You've got the deeper brackets on it. Yeah. I still love that camera. And when you pick it up, you think, wow, Nikon really nailed the ergonomics on that. And it was such an influential camera, I believe, for Canon when they did the 7D, is that a lot of the ergonomics of the 7D that make it feel so good.
Yeah.
If you pick up a Nikon camera, you think, well, wait a minute, I think I've kind of felt that style before. But it is infuriating how many manufacturers think that bracketing is a professional feature that will only that demands a pro DSLR and a pro DSLR price. Why not put it into more affordable products? I get this all the time, people saying, you know, why don't they do it? There are some workarounds. Scott Kublin has got a neat one where on Canon where he uses the custom preset modes on the mode dial to kind of bracket one set and then bracket another, although you are physically moving the camera a little bit, so there's a bit of risk there. Some people do some great remote controls which have got bracketing features in them. Some of them control it via the USB. Eden Braxton of Photography in Queenstown was showing me one for his Canon. That was really neat. It was effectively duplicating what you'd get from the EOS utility on a laptop on a USB connection. So you can do it with that. So there's lots of workarounds. If you want it built into a Nikon or Canon body, unfortunately, you're going to have to go for a higher end one. And it's, I guess the more people that shout about it, you know, the better, because other manufacturers are getting in on the act. I mean, I've shown this camera on many hangouts with Trey before. This is the Panasonic GX1. It's a mirrorless ILC, but it's a seven-frame bracketing. Why can't everyone else do that? It's, you know, why reserve it? I think in a way maybe they're saying that people shouldn't be doing HDR. And is that a bad thing?
Sinners.
Yeah, maybe it's like HDR censorship.
Well, let's end the show on that note. thank you guys very much for coming. I appreciate you all, and thanks everyone in the chat room and everyone watching. It was great. I had a lot of fun. I hope you did too. All right. Well, join us next week. Same bat time, same bat channel, and we'll do it all again. Okay. Bye, everybody.
Bye, everybody.
Thanks. Bye. Bye.